Assalamualaikum everyone, Sir Fahad Ali, your favorite teacher, again with a new video. Yesterday I uploaded a video on society ke soch. The video was given more views, more likes than I was expecting. There were some great comments down, but I didn't reply to those comments because I didn't get time to see those comments. I noticed that I have some comments in that video. So that was somehow that was a reflection of the society, how the society thinks, how we think, because society is made up of individuals. So that was our own thinking, not of the society. So this is chapter 3 of business studies according to Karen Burrington. So very quickly starting the chapter 3, the first topic in chapter 3 is characteristics of successful entrepreneur. As you all would be familiar with the term entrepreneur, entrepreneur is someone who is the risk taker, who has the risk taking ability, but it is an individual. The individual who is taking risk will be called as entrepreneur. There are some characteristics of successful entrepreneur. That successful entrepreneur must have these characteristics. He must be hardworking, he is always a risk taker, creative, he is optimistic, positive about future, he is self-confident that if he has incurred some sort of losses or if his company is suffering a loss, then he would come back to a profit again. He is innovative, thinking about new innovations, thinking about new methods to do something. He is always independent and an effective communicator. If a person is not an effective communicator, then he cannot be a better entrepreneur, because ineffective communication in any organization will make the organization fail very soon. So I have put an abbreviation, COSIEHR. I has a square because we have two I, innovative and independent. So this is an abbreviation. You can rephrase it in order to make some word. It was difficult for me to make a word, so I have put the alphabets only. Then we have why government support business startups. Startups are a business just started by an entrepreneur. So the government sometimes support businesses. So there is a reason behind the government supporting those startups. The first reason is it reduces unemployment. If the government is supporting a new startup, then it will almost reduce the unemployment. That is the aim of the government in any economy. The government always aim to reduce unemployment. The second is it increases competition. As the businesses are increasing and growing, so it will increase the competition for other businesses. That will increase efficiency and the product would be priced competitively in accordance with the other companies. The third is increases output. As I said, that increased competition, it is linked with increased competition. After increasing competition, the increased competition, I said, we have efficiency. If efficiency increases due to the increase in competition, it is most obvious that the output would also increase. The second last is it would benefit society. How it would benefit society? In terms of the products which are available in the market. For example, previously four businesses used to supply that product. After some time, a new business started and that came into the market. Now I have five companies supplying the same product. So it will benefit the society to make the best choice available out of the options available to that society. The last is it can grow further. When a business grows further, the government earns some sort of taxes, tax revenues, which will benefit the government in the long run. The fourth slide is saying what support does government give to support startups. As government supports a startup, we all agree to this point. We said why government support a startup, there were some reasons. Then after that we have how the government support startups. What support does the government provide? The government provides business ideas and helps. Several conferences are held which are free of cost in several countries, in which there are some ideas, there are some techniques which are told to them, which are told to the entrepreneurs in order to survive better in a market. The government sometimes gives premises at a low rent. As there are some areas in which the government want to give that land or that area to some businesses at a low rent. Why? Because that area might have some sort of unemployment, that area might not be developed as the government want to develop that area. So it will give a low cost rent to the business. So it would encourage the business. The third is finance. Sometimes the government gives some sort of small loans to the businesses, to some businesses. So that's why it is written that the third point is finance. The fourth is labor. Sometimes the government encourages the labor to go into that area, and there are some benefits provided by the government to work in that area. The last is research center. Sometimes there are some research centers in some companies. So the government provides some support, some facilities, some subsidies, some schemes in order to support the research areas of some businesses. Now the most important thing, it is the business plan. What is a business plan? First of all, we should learn this concept, business plan. Business plan is a document used for taking loans and convincing others about their business objectives, finance, and the products in which the business deals. It is a document used when, for example, my company suffered loss of 1 lakh. I want to take a loan from a bank. When I went to the bank asked me, do you have a plan for future? How would you recover? How would you pay back your loan to us? When the bank manager asked me this thing before giving me the loan, I was shocked because this is a quite new term for me. So I went home, I researched something, and then I got to know that business plan is a document from which I made the business plan, that document which is required to convince the bank in order to give me loan. I prepared the business plan documents. After this example, I would discuss on the characteristics. I made the business plan document. In the business plan document, I put some sort of heading, some sort of discussion, some sort of details about my business, and then I made a file. I provided that file to the bank and asked the bank manager to give me the loan. If the bank manager would be convinced about my plans, about the details of the business, how I would pay back the loan, then he is most probably, he will give me the loan, will provide me with the loan. If he is not convinced with my business plan, then most probably he will not give me the loan. He will ask me to leave the bank for the loan because he is not convinced, or he is thinking that my business is more riskier, so he cannot give the loan. What are the corrections? When I would be making business plan, the first thing which would come in my mind is that what I should write in the business plan. The first thing would be aims and objectives. What are the aims of the business, the objectives of the business, what the business wants to achieve. The second is the details of the product. For example, I am dealing in pencils, so I would be writing the details about the product in which I am dealing. The third is market information, the number of customers, the market share, the sales. And as far as market share is concerned, it would be a new concept for all of you. Market share is the sales of the business divided by the total sales of the industry. And as far as industry is concerned, industry would cater all the businesses selling the same product, would form an industry, as we sometimes use the term automobile industry. So in automobile industry, all the businesses which are selling the cars and these things would be involved in the automobile industry. So industry is related to all businesses selling the same product. So market share is sales of the business divided by the total sales of the industry in which the business is operating. Then after market information, we have how and where product is to be made. The manufacturing process, the operations, and these things should be included. The second last is number and type of employees. How many employees I have in my company, and the type of employees, whether those employees are part-time employees, those are full-time employees, how they are managed, and what is their contract, the contract type. The last is the finance required, the cash flow forecast. For example, I am planning that I would take a loan from the bank, and I am about to generate 6 lakh revenue from after taking loan. I can reschedule my marketing plans, and then I would go for a sales revenue of 6 lakh. I am planning this. So this plan should be written down in the business plan, and I should convince the bank that my assumption is valid. I am not assuming more regarding my plans. So the assumption should be valid, and this should be convinced to the bank manager when I am taking loans. The next slide is comparing the business size. My business is a big business or a small business. Sometimes some owners want to know this, and those people who want to know this are in the list who would find it useful to compare the size of businesses. The first is the investors. Almost every investor would find out whether the business is a big business or a small business. The second is government. Government is sometimes interested as some plans are given according to the size of the business. Some tax revenues, some taxes are imposed according to the size of the business. The third is competitors. Competitors will always be eager to learn about your own business size, that how big your business is. The fourth is workers. Workers are always concerned about this because workers want to work in a company which is big enough, which is prestigious. So the last is banks. Banks would also find it interesting to find the size of a business. So these all examples, these all people are more eager to find out whether your business is a small business or a big business. Now the next is comparing the size of businesses. Business size can be measured in number of ways. The most common are value of employees, value of output, value of sales and value of capital employed. Coming down to the first method, it is number of employees. It is comparing the number of employees of the business with other businesses, as it is very simple, the name suggests. Then we have limitations for every method. The first limitation is capital intensive businesses cannot be compared with this method, as there are some businesses who rely more on machineries. So we cannot compare that business with this method because this method would fail when there are more machineries in the business. The second is part-time employees. What should we do with the part-time employees? Either to include them in the number of employees or do not include them in the number of employees. This is a question mark. The next is value of output. Value of output methods can be used in manufacturing businesses and can be used for other businesses which are involved in making of some sort of products. Value of output, as the name suggests, what is the worth of the output which is being produced by the business. The number one limitation is very few employing people might be making very expensive products, as a business employing few people might be making products which are more expensive. So this is a limitation of value of output. Value of output and value of sales are different terms. This is an important limitation. Value of output is something produced by the business. It is not mandatory that thing should be sold. And value of sales is the actual sales of the product sold in the business. So these both terms are different. Value of sales. This value of sales method is most commonly used for retailer businesses. The limitations are businesses with different products cannot be compared. As a business is selling pencils and another business is selling, for example, chocolates. So we cannot compare these both businesses because comparison is always like with like. So the comparison is not logical. The next is value of capital employed. This means the value of capital invested into the business. By capital, I mean the machineries used in the business. Limitations are some companies may be labor intensive, as some companies might be using more labor than the machineries. The second is low output might be produced using machineries. There might be less output being produced by the machines because the machineries are too old to produce more things. The next is why do owners often want their businesses to grow? The first reason is possibility of higher status. As some businesses became brands in past, so the owners have higher status. The second is more status and prestige for owners. It is the same point somehow. More status, most prestige for the owners. The third is possibility of higher profits. If my business is growing, then there would be a possibility that my profits would also be increasing. The fourth is lower average cost. As my business is big enough, then I can more bargain with my supplier if my business is small. So it is difficult for small businesses to bargain with the supplier because small businesses are always purchasing small quantities and big businesses are purchases. Large businesses are purchasing always more quantities from the supplier. So it makes it easier for the business to bargain on the prices. The last is larger market share. Larger market share, as I explained the term market share. So more market share would be there. Now we have how businesses can grow. Businesses can grow either internally or externally. इंटरनल ग्रोथ और एक्सटर्नल ग्रोथ। इंटरनल ग्रोथ हैज थ्री मेथड्स, हॉरिजॉन्टल मर्जर, वर्टिकल मर्जर एंड कॉन्ग्लोमरेट। एक्सटर्नल ग्रोथ कैन ओनली बी डन बाय टेक ओवर्स विथ अदर बिजनेसेस। हॉरिजॉन्टल ग्रोथ, व्हेन अ बिजनेस टेक्स ओवर और मर्जेस विथ अनदर बिजनेस एट द सेम लेवल ऑफ प्रोडक्शन इन द सेम इंडस्ट्री। फॉर एग्जाम्पल, आई एम एट द प्राइमरी स्टेज ऑफ प्रोडक्शन, माई डीलिंग इज विद द नेचर, आई एम डूइंग फिशिंग। When I am merging with a business who is also doing fishing, then this will be considered as horizontal merger because we both are at the same level of production. The advantages are merger will reduce competitors. First, the business was the another business with whom I merged was my competitor. After my merger, my competitors would be eliminated or it will be reduced. Opportunities to reduce average cost. As my business grows in size because of the merger, then our cost would be lower as production would also increase. As an increase in production and efficiency would always reduce the cost. Combined businesses will have increased market share. Obviously, both businesses combined, the sales of that business and my business would be combined, then it will increase my market share. Then we have vertical growth. Vertical growth has two kinds, vertical forward or vertical backward. Vertical forward growth is when a business merges or takes over another business with forward stage of production. Examples include mobile manufacturer merges with mobile retailers. I am manufacturing mobile and I have merged or taken over a business which is a mobile retailer. So this will be called as a vertical forward growth. Going forward to one stage of production, I am at the stage of production of manufacturing, then the other stage of production is the selling. So I am going one step forward. So this will be called as vertical forward growth. The advantages are merger gives an assured outlet for the product. Obviously, first it was difficult for me to sell my products. Then I have an outlet after the merger. The profit margin made by the retailer is taken after the merger. When I merged with that business, the retailer business, then the profit margin which was earlier taken by the retailer would be taken by me. The third point is retailer could be made bound to sell only the business after merger. The retailer can be made bound to sell the products of the business only. He can be asked not to market other products. The last is information can be obtained easily about customer preferences due to being close. As sometimes the retailers are very close to the customers, then it becomes very easier to know the preferences of the customers. So it will reduce the chances of business failure too. Now we have vertical backward growth. Vertical backward growth is when a business merges or takes over another business with the backward stage of production. We are at manufacturing stage, then we go to the backward stage. Example is there, include mobile manufacturer merger with the spare parts dealer. Advantages include it gives an assured supply of important components. There would be some components which are always needed for making manufacturing mobile, so there would be an assured supply. The second is profit margin on supplies absorbed by the expanded business. Earlier our spare parts dealer would use to charge us $70. Now after the merger he has cut down the profit, now he charges us $60. So this profit margin would be absorbed by the business after the merger. Supplier could be asked to supply the business only. The spare parts dealer can be asked to supply the business only. Cost of components and supplies might become cheap. Why? Because earlier I used to get it with the profit margin being charged by the spare parts dealer. But after the merger, he won't charge me the profit. I will only bear the cost. Conglomerate growth. Conglomerate growth is when a business merges or takes over another business in another industry. This is, for example, I am dealing in cars and I merged or I took over a business in another industry. That industry could be either the stationery industry, either it could be the mobile phone industry or these things. In short, the concept is related to that the business would not be related to the business in which we are dealing. The business would now have, there are two advantages. The business would now have activities in more than one industry as we have shifted in another industry. There is a name given to conglomerate growth. It is diversification. earlier we were in only one industry. Now we have come into two industries after the merger or takeover. There can be transfer of ideas between different businesses and different industries. There would be some transfer of ideas, the dealings, how to deal with the customers, how to manage the business. The next is problems of business growth. Larger businesses are difficult to control. This problem can be resolved by operating in small businesses, small units. Every there and then, we have some larger businesses that are difficult to control. So the problem would be resolved by operating in small units. The second problem would be poor communication. Use of technology in communication can help. This is a solution. Expansion cost will make the business short of finance. Expanding slowly can help. And the other solution is, and the business can take a loan by making a business plan and presenting it to the bank. The last is different management styles and cultures. A new management style can be chosen and communicated to staff for the need of change. As new management style can be chosen and it should be communicated to the staff that we felt a need to change the management style. The second last is, why do businesses stay small? Some businesses want to stay small. The reason is the type of industry in which the business operates. The type of industry in which the business operates is very small. There are few businesses in the industry, so the business always remains small. The example could be hair salon, the barber shops. These barber shops are operating in an industry where there are small businesses, less businesses for these services. The second is the market size, the number of customers which are there. When taking the examples of a barber shop, when I go for a haircut, then the next time I would go for a haircut would be after 2 to 3 months, not every day. So the number of customers are less in this. The last is owner's objective. The owner might be wanting to keep the business small. Why? The reason is that keeping the business small would help him have more control. He will not face some sort of communication problem, some sort of management problem and these things. So he want to keep it small. The last slide is, why businesses fail? An important question. There might be an poor management. The management must not have the good skills to run a business. The second is failure to plan for change. Business environment is dynamic. Dynamic means environment which is changing continuously. When we fail to plan according to the environment, then the business is surely or will probably fail. The third is poor financial management, shortage of cash. The cash manager or the person responsible for cash, he doesn't manage the cash more effectively, and the business was short of finance, short of cash. So that's why the business failed. The fourth is overexpansion. Overexpansion is when we are expanding and after expanding, we got to know that we don't have any cash available. It is more or less linked to the poor financial management, or the cash is being used to buy some sort of stock or inventories, and the cash is tied up in the inventories. So this will be called as over expansion. The last risk of new business is startups. There are some businesses which start after some time and they are liked by the customers. So it will take the customers away from us. So it will be difficult for the existing business to survive in the market. So that's why the business would fail if he doesn't plan for the change. Okay, this was chapter 3. If you have any questions, you can comment in the comment section down below. If you have any queries, you can ask in the comment section. Like this video, share this video, subscribe to my channel Fahad Ali Commerce Faculty. If you have any problem, any questions, you can ask me. Stay blessed, stay inspired, and love you all.